Good morning to all kids. As this is the last chapter of your book, and today we are going to this drama in a different way. Okay? So, first of all, I am going to introduce all the characters who are there in this drama. First, the name, as it says, the purloined letter. Purloined means the stolen one. This drama or the act is about a letter which is being stolen, okay, and it's divided in 5 to 6 scenes. The characters are, first is Dupin. The Dupin is a private detective in Paris. The plot is set up in the Paris, wo France ke background pe pura jo plot hai wo set kiya hua hai, okay. The next is prefect of police. The prefect of the police means the head of the Paris police force, okay. The third one is Edgar. The Edgar is Dupin's best friend, and the Edgar himself is the narrator also. The narrator is the person who says what is going on in the scene. Wo aapko batata bhi jayega that what the next scene is all about. Okay? Then the king, the ruler of the France, and then the queen, the king's young wife. She is the one whose letter is stolen. And the narrator at the end himself is Edgar. Okay? So now, one by one, let us come to the scene 1.
Hello, I am narrator, the Edgar. Just after dark, one gusty autumn evening, I was enjoying a visit with my friend, C. August Dupin. As we sat in silence, the door was thrown open and in came our old acquaintance, the prefect of the police.
Hello, I'm Dupin, a private detective in Paris. Greetings, my friend. Have a seat. To what do we owe the honor of this visit?
Hello, everyone. It's me, Prefect of Police, the head of the Paris Police Force. I have come to ask your opinion on something, Dupin. It's official business that is causing me a great deal of trouble.
Ah, if it is anything requiring thought, we should discuss it while sitting in the dark.
Now there is another one of your odd.
The prefect called everything odd that was beyond his own comprehension. He lived in a world full of oddities. What is the difficulty now? A murder?
Oh no, nothing like that. The fact is, the mystery is very simple indeed. I don't doubt that we can solve it ourselves. But then I thought Dupin would like to hear the details of the case because it is so well odd.
A mystery that is simple and odd.
Why? Yes, and not exactly that either. The fact is, we have been puzzled because the mystery is so simple, yet it has us Dupin.
Perhaps it is the simplicity of the case which baffles you.
What nonsense.
Perhaps the mystery is a little too plain.
Oh, good heavens. Who ever heard of such an idea?
A little too self-evident.
Oh, Dupin, you will be the death of me yet.
And what are the facts of this mystery?
I will tell you, but before I begin, let me caution you that this case demands the greatest secrecy. I would lose my job if anyone found out I told you about the case.
Proceed.
Or not.
Well then, here are the facts.
Scene 2.
The prefect told us his story. It started a few months before when the Queen of France received a letter. She was reading it alone in the royal rooms when the king entered.
King.
My dear, what is that you are reading?
This? Oh, it is nothing.
The queen began to hide the letter in a drawer, then decided it best to simply toss it over her desk So, as not to arouse suspicion at that instance, Minister D entered the room.
Your Majesties, thank you for seeing me. I have a few matters of business to discuss.
You may proceed.
Thank you, but here, Majesty, the Queen seems nervous.
Oh, it's nothing.
I see.
Minister D, being a bold scoundrel, immediately saw that the letter was important to the Queen. What is more, he could see that she wished to hide it from the King. Minister D placed a letter he had brought with him onto the desk next to the Queen's letter. Then began discussing business. After 15 minutes or so, he deliberately picked up the Queen's letter, leaving his own.
No.
Is something wrong, Your Highness?
What is it?
Dear.
Oh, nothing.
Very good. I will leave you now. Good day, Your Majesty. Your Highness, I'm sure you will talk soon.
Scene 3.
So it's blackmail?
Exactly. Minister D has the letter. He threatens to give it to the King unless the Queen does just as he asks. Minister D has used his power to gain political advantage. The Queen is desperate to get the letter back and has given the job to me.
And no better detective could be desired or even imagined.
You flatter me? But it is possible that was Her Majesty's opinion.
Is it certain that Mr. D still has the letter?
He must. For his blackmail to work, he must be in a position to show the King the letter immediately. If he had already done so, I'm sure that all of Paris would know.
But you are quite skilled in these investigations. You have done this sort of things often before.
Oh, yes. And for this reason, I had great hopes. Minister D is seldom home at night. I have keys, as you know, which can open any room or cabinet in Paris. For the past 3 months, we have been busy ransacking Minister D's apartment. To no avail, we have not found the letter.
Is it possible that Mr. D is carrying the letter with him?
No. 3 times I have had patrolmen waylay Minister D and search him. He did not have the letter with him.
You could have spread yourself the trouble. The minister is not altogether a fool and would have expected these searches.
Did you search Minister D's apartment thoroughly?
Of course. We took our time and searched everywhere. We opened every possible drawer.
How about secret drawers?
There is no such thing to the trained eye. We propped the furniture cushions with long needles. We carefully took apart the tables and chairs.
Why on earth did you do that?
A letter could be hidden in a hollow leg or under the top of a table or seat of a chair.
Was this letter hidden in that fashion?
No, we put the furniture back together. Then we looked behind mirrors and pictures, in the mattress and bedclothes, behind curtains and under carpets. Then we searched the building itself. We divided its surface into sections, which we numbered. We examined every square inch with a microscope, searching for a secret compartment. Then we searched the houses on either side of Minister D's house.
The two other houses, you have had a great deal of trouble.
Yes, but Her Majesty has offered a substantial reward.
Reward or no, you have not found the letter. You must be mistaken in thinking Minister D has it in his room.
I am afraid you are right, Dupin. What do you think I should do?
Keep looking.
Is that the best advice you can give?
As you said, the letter must be somewhere close at hand. You see, you haven't found it yet. Do you have a description of the letter?
Yes, I do.
The perfect took out a notebook and read a detailed description of the missing document. After he finished reading the description, he left, more depressed than I had ever seen him. Now, the scene 4. After about a month later, Prefect paid us another visit.
Well, Prefect, what about the Pauline letter? Did you find it?
No, confound it. Although I followed Dupin's advice and searched Minister D's room again, it was wasted time, as I knew it would be.
How much was the reward offered? Did you say?
Why, quite a lot. I hesitate to say exactly how much, but it's big enough that I would gladly write a check in the amount of 50,000 francs to anyone who could give me the letter.
In that case, get out your checkbook. When you have signed a check to me for that amount, I will give you the letter.
I was astounded. The prefect was absolutely thunderstruck. He stared silently at my friend, then took out his checkbook, wrote a check for 50,000 francs and handed it to Dupin. My friend studied it carefully for a moment, slipped it into his pocketbook, then unlocked his desk drawer. He took out a letter and handed it to the prefect.
But, how?
Then, without another word, the prefect rushed out of our rooms with the letter.
The police are very able in their way. Unfortunately, they are no brighter or stupider than the common mass of people. Their investigations often fail when they encounter a criminal smarter than they are, and often when they deal with criminals who are not as smart.
But they conducted a thorough search.
Of course. But they searched in places where they themselves might have hidden the letter. They did not think that Minister D, who is no fool, would anticipate that his rooms would be searched. Of course, he would never hide the letter behind a mirror or in a hollow table leg, because if he did, it would certainly be found. He would choose a simpler place to hide it. In fact, he would choose not to hide it at all.
I think I understand your reasoning, but how did you manage to get hold of the letter?
It was simple. I took it.
Scene 5.
Dupin told me how he paid a visit to Minister D himself.
Why? Hello, Dupin. What brings you to my rooms?
I was in the neighborhood and thought I would stop in for a chat.
Come in, my friend. It is good to see you. But why are you wearing dark glasses?
My eyes are tired and the light bothers them.
Dupin actually wore the glasses so that his eyes could wander around the room without Minister D suspecting. It did not take long for Dupin to find what he was looking for. His eyes soon fell on a cheap card rack which dangled from a dirty blue ribbon above the fireplace mantel. In the rack, plain to see, was a letter. Unlike the purloined letter, it was dirty and crumpled, with a woman's handwriting on the outside. Dupin stayed for a while chatting with the minister.
Thank you for seeing me, sir. I have enjoyed our chat.
So have I. Please feel free to call again.
Dupin left the room.
Dupin, wait. The fool, he left his snuff box behind.
Scene 6.
The next day, Dupin returned to the rooms of Minister D.
I'm sorry to trouble you, my friend. I forgot something yesterday.
Your snuff box, here it is. What is that?
A sound like gunfire cracked through the air, followed by screams. Minister D rushed to the window. As Minister D looked out the window, Dupin walked over to the mantel, took the rag litter from the rack and replaced it with an exact duplicate he had made.
It is nothing. Some prankster burst a balloon. Well, Dupin, will you stay to chat?
I'm afraid not, my friend. I have what I came for.
Scene 7.
Dupin smiled and satisfaction as he told me his story.
Of course, the prankster with the balloon was an agent I had hired to distract the minister.
But the letter you took looked nothing like the Queen's letter. Hers was neat and addressed in a man's hand. The letter in the rack was ragged, covered with dirt, and addressed by a woman.
Of course, it was unlike the Queen's letter in every detail that I knew it must be a fake. When I got it back here, I found the Queen's letter wrapped up inside the false letter.
Does Minister D know he has been hacked?
I doubt it. The copy I made of his letter is perfect. He has no reason to open it up, not until the Queen defies him. When that happens, he is in for a rude surprise.
Oh yes? What did you say in the letter you left?
Oh, just a personal message. Something along the lines that scoundrels can hide in plain sight, but not forever.
Here, the act ends. Thank you.